So it's a real pleasure to have Mark Heilty with us today. Mark's coming from the University of Minnesota, where he's a professor in the Department of Communication Studies, and he's an affiliate in the Department of Anthropology. He's going to be talking about his current book that's just out, A Song to Save the Salish Sea, and it's a musical performance as environmental communication. As I told Mark before, I was really pleased when Kirsten suggested that we have Mark, because I know his work from a very different period in his life, from ethnographic research, which was about foreign correspondence. It was called War Stories. It's just a fantastic ethnography of war reporting in El Salvador. And so I'm very excited to hear about his most recent ethnographic work, which is much closer to home for us, and I suspect a little happier in focus. So he's going to talk for about 45 minutes, and then we'll have Q&A.
Yeah, sounds good.
Thank you, Matt. And thank you, Kirsten, Matt, and everybody for being here and hosting me, because it's kind of exciting for me to speak at the University of Washington. My father-in-law played basketball here in the 50s. The in-laws all have some sort of Huskies connection. And whenever I go to Whidbey Island to visit my mother-in-law, there's a sign that says Husky parking to the left, and there's this nice clean garage where you can go in and park, and Bruin parking to the right, which is a sort of gravel parking lot outside, and that's where my wife and I are supposed to park because we're both UCLA and Berkeley products. So it's kind of fun having to be invited into a warm place at the University of Washington to talk about this. I also think, before I get started here, I always find there's real similarities in scale, our states, in terms of the University of Washington, University of Minnesota. And one of the things I'm always really fascinated by is being somewhat of an interloper in communication studies for the last now 10, 12 years, is the ways in which that the disciplines are configured so differently on the two institutions that are otherwise so similar. And I think we have a lot to learn from the University of Washington in that regard, from talking to folks about your own transition. In preparing for this, I started thinking a little bit about some of the work I've done since the book, and I'm going to talk mainly about the fieldwork for the book, but I've really realized the extent to which this last part is important in terms of what I'm doing. I think that in so much of our work, we either implicitly or explicitly say, here's why we're doing this. And there's often that kind of implicit assumption that somebody should do something about this after we get done with the research. And I've kind of come to the point where I've realized, usually if that's not ourselves, it might not be the case that anything really happens with it beyond, you know, somebody reading it in a conference kind of setting, perhaps using it in a course, which is our probably most important use of our scholarship. So I've moved on to some applied work based on this field work that I want to share with you as well, in part because in some ways, for me at least, it's helped me think through some of the things I did in the field work and in the book in retrospect. So I want to start out by saying the first place where a lot of these questions was generated, in 2012 I published a book called Ecomusicology, Rock, Folk, and the Environment, when the discussion of the American Musicological Society and the Society for Ethnomusicology, and to a certain extent the EASP and the International Association for the Study of Popular Music, was just starting to catch up in terms of thinking about environment as it related to music. I think music was a little bit of a latecomer to some environmental questions. And so as a result, I found myself both satisfied that that work raised certain questions, but dissatisfied that I didn't really feel like I was answering many. So as I thought about the work I had done in that book, I started thinking, I want to start getting at some more answers. And I thought, where might I do that? And that's where I ended up around the Salish Sea doing this work. Now, partly it's a convenient sample. I spend my summers here, as Kirsten knows, and part of my holiday break. But also because, as you know, in this area there's an incredible reputation for environmental movements and environmental work, and therefore it was a place to find a critical mass of musicians doing the sort of work I'm going to talk about. And so that's really what brought me here in terms of doing this field work, which to a certain extent I felt like I was answering my questions then. Now, whether or not it is ethnography, I like to actually talk about that in terms of methodology. I would say it's more case studies where I'm interviewing these musicians, observing what they do, but not in a way that, as an anthropological ethnographer, I think of in terms of really immersive participant observation. Another thing about, I think, the Salish Sea, as far as sound studies is concerned, is there's a rich tradition here of sound studies that really one enters into by coming to this area. Especially, I think, when we think about Vancouver and R. Murray Schafer and his soundscape studies. He's really the person that kind of coined the term. Westerkamp, who very much as far as sound study and sound performance and as a recordist, and Barry Truax and others at Simon Fraser and UBC that worked in this area. And then down here in Washington, you got Gordon Hempton. How many of you have heard of Gordon Hempton? You don't have to, if you. What's that?
Not until I read your book.
Right, and there's a, and I think that there's a reason for that in the sense that he was a big seller outside of the academy, but he's not really an academic, not a scholar writing this. But I think he really wrote a nice book called One Square Inch of Silence. And he's based in the Olympics, and he's a recording engineer. Started getting tinnitus. Really started concerning himself with the loss of natural sound in wilderness areas. And he's probably done more than anybody in terms of his crusade to get the National Park Service and others to think about the element of sound when they think about wilderness and when they think about biodiversity and environmental health. And so he's had great success in stopping some overflights, for example, over the Olympic rainforest. And he's still on this crusade, if you will, but the fact that this is ground zero for this, or the Olympics are at least ground zero for this, makes this just a rich area in which to study sound in this fashion. So, you know, I was asking, as opposed to the other book I mentioned, I was asking a fairly functionalist question here, almost unashamedly functionalist, as in, what does music do? Of course, I'm interested in, as an anthropologist, what does music mean, some of the traditional questions, but Jake Harwood at University of Arizona raised this good point that we have a tendency to just assume music does these great things because it's so, essentially part of representing movements. And I wanted to sort of think about music in terms of efficacy with movements, not just in an instrumentalist way, but what does it do in terms of the culture of a movement, and how might we understand that deeply by doing ethnographic, or in this case, case study work with these folks. And I had three criteria, therefore, to choose these cases. And this is the first time I've really ever done this, where I kind of pre-select and really want to work with musicians that fit a certain fairly narrow model. One is they have to be environmentally themed. That right away cuts out most musicians. I mean, most musicians are not topical, let alone on a specific topic like that. But the main criteria was one, that they're articulated in some way with a movement or policy issue or issues. In other words, it's hard to understand how what they're doing could meaningfully move the needle, if you will, to use the cliche, if they don't have some kind of connection like that, other than that sort of good faith that you put something out in the world and hope it matters. So that was a sort of first criterion. A second one was that they have some sort of following, authentic following. As in, I can pick a djembe right now and go to an Idle No More protest and say, well, I'm a musician, I'm connected to a movement, the movement's had some success, ergo, I'd be a decent case for this. No, I really wanted to see the sort of palpable, visceral evidence that they're having some kind of impact on an audience or audiences. And you'll see that that's an important criterion. The third one is the one that's most problematic in terms of any kind of movement or policy issue. And that is even going a step further to say that there's some evidence that they've made, that their policy or movement has made a difference. Now, that's a really high criterion for anything. Going back in my own movement work, whether it's anti-apartheid, Central American Solidarity, I wouldn't say there's one where you can ever point to anything and say, this is what made a difference. It's almost impossible to measure that or determine. Yet at the same time, applying these criteria, I believe that there are some cases in which you could make that argument, such as with Dana Lyons, who's going to be one of the first cases I show. that when he set out to do what he was doing, there were several cases in which almost nobody was raising awareness about these issues. And the fact that he was part of sustained organizer, like a Pete Seeger as a musician organizer, probably did make a difference in that particular movement. And that's an argument I'm going to make. But like I said, the first two criteria were the most important. So that's how I selected out these cases here around the Salish Sea. So now, having said how I selected them, I want to say a little bit about what I came up with, or rather what these informants taught me about making music in an environmentalist context. The first one that I'll talk about today is that of genre. Before I do that, though, before I kind of give you some of the results, I'm not going to read from the book here. It's not a book talk of that sort, but I do want to just read a couple paragraphs because I think this gives you a sense of what I was doing, what I was just saying. As an applied scholar, I hope this is actionable intelligence. One of the main reasons I undertook this work was to find ways of composing, recording, distributing, and performing community-based music from an ecological standpoint. I was interested in learning from successful artists, and having mined the Salish Sea region for best cases, I've discovered many worth emulating. Scholars of community music have long encouraged us to take our work beyond the academy, borrowing good ideas from one another. The New Advocacy Ethnomusicology, explained Jennifer Post, who's been very involved in the ecomusicology discussion I mentioned before, is used to seek solutions for contemporary social problems. That is the objective of this work, to use real-world examples in order to provide musicians, organizers, students, music researchers, and other citizens with new ideas regarding how we might advocate for more effective environmental policies, institutions, and actions. So what is the reader to do with all this? How does it help anyone to know how Dana Lyons put together campaign tours? The Wilds teach children about intertidal zones. The Raging Grannies agitate for ecological sanity. Adrian Shalafour sings for trees. The Earthlings bring together a community. Or Idle No More builds broad coalitions throughout Canada. I cannot say for certain, but I do know that there's much more to be done in the applied study of environmentalist music. And so this work continues on ecosong.net, a digital exchange designed to continue and expand the work. Reading about these inspiring artists will, I hope, be a catalyst for cultural action. Performance is particularly important for environmental movements, explains David Terry and Anne-Marie Todd, because effective environmental activism must be able to not only critique existing relationships, but also model alternative modes of belonging, unquote. Alternative modes of belonging must be imagined and performed before they are realized. Most people appreciate the beauty and meaning in music, but we sometimes forget how important music is to our collective lives. As these talented artists have demonstrated time and again, when it comes to preserving a planet, a community, or sea, nothing is more essential than music. And so one of the things I think coming into this work, I expected, and I think audiences often expect when it comes to environment, there's all these discourses of dystopian discourses around environmental issues. You know, what's going wrong in terms of climate change. And I think even based on my own sort of experience and movements, I kind of expected to see that the successful environmentalist musicians might be of the sort that you see when you go to a demonstration or a protest, and at the end they kind of parade everybody in front and it becomes this obligatory, almost perfunctory ritual. What I found was anything but. It seemed like the musicians that were successful at this, stayed at this, were much like Dana Lyons, who was really going counter to genre expectations in that way and has for four decades. And I want to deal with Dana as probably the first and best case of somebody that is able to surprise the audience with what he does and therefore be very successful. I'm going to talk just very briefly about Dana as a case, and then before I talk about his politics of polysemy, and he will hear Dana's voice, but I first want to just briefly mention what he does. Since the 1980s, when he graduates from Swarthmore, what he does is he maps his tours onto environmental issues. So in the 1980s, the Department of Energy was going to start dumping commercial nuclear waste at Hanford. Now you can imagine, given that Hanford is the largest Superfund site in the country, what would have happened if they would have essentially continued dumping, in this case, commercial as well as military waste there. And frankly, when he was going along I-90 doing his tour, going through places like Minnesota, small towns in the middle of winter, doing satirical work where news on slow news days, cameras would come out and say, what's going on with this concert next to the highway? He would say things like, I know you never have accidents along here, but you might not realize the Department of Energy is about to send nuclear waste through here, and had sort of a cask of fake nuclear waste there and that kind of thing. And it really raised awareness, and it kind of caught him the bug that he had a method there that was very successful. Well, he's still doing that, and I want you to hear just his voice real briefly here as he speaks to, speaks to his methodology. In this case, the anti-Coltrane tours where he goes through eastern Montana and followed the Coltrane routes.
So I did a tour following the whole route. I went and met with ranchers who were affected in eastern Montana. I met with 5 ranching families. And I did concerts the whole way back to Bellingham. And what I found particularly fascinating was all different types of people came to my shows. There were Democrats and Republicans coming to my shows. And not everyone would agree with everything I would say, but one thing we all agreed on is we're going to stop the coal train. And so it's been so kind of my role as a musician was one to just let people know that this was happening, but also I think we can win. I thought we could win from the very beginning. I think we can beat all 6. And when you have so many people against you, it comes down to one line. I start out all my shows, I'm going to talk a little bit about the Coltrane proposal, I'm going to sing some funny songs, and then describe how we're going to beat it. And the way we're going to beat it comes down to one line. What do we get out of this deal? And the bottom line is, to do the comedy country music thing, they get the coal mine, we get the shaft. And this is why they're going to lose. This is why Warren Buffett and Peabody Coal and Goldman Sachs, those are our adversaries. They are going to lose. And the reason they're going to lose is because there's the whole region's against it. And the former governor of Montana, he said it quite accurately, and he's a pro-coal guy. He goes...
All right. You notice there's a lot of background noise there. There's this restaurant we go to in Bellingham always when I meet up with Dana. And it's actually the same place where the mariachis play that are in a video or in a song you've heard of his, possibly called Cows with Guns. And Cows with Guns, I want to play you just a little bit of this because I think when I talk about the politics of polysemy, it's a perfect example. Conservative ranchers will invite him to because they know this song that was a number one hit in some markets, as will vegetarians. And it gives this sort of Freirean opening for dialogue that I don't think would be there if he was using just simply didactic, hit you over the head sort of music. So once again, using sort of comedy as a genre as an opening to talk about very important issues. I'll just play a little bit of this in case you haven't seen it.
Fat and docile, big and dumb, they look so stupid, they aren't much fun. Cows aren't fun. They eat to grow, grow to die, die to be dead at the hamburger fry. Cows well done. Nobody thunk it, nobody knew, no one imagined the great cow guru. Cows are one. He hid in the forest, read books with great zeal. He loved Che Guevara, a revolutionary veal. Cows say tongue. He spoke about justice, but nobody stirred. He felt like an outcast, alone in the herd. Cow doll drums. He moved, we must fight, escape or we'll die. Cows gathered around, cause the stakes were so high. Bad cow pun. But then he was captured, stuffed into a crate, loaded onto a truck, where he rode to his fate. Cows are bum. He was a scrawny calf, who looked rather woozy. No one suspected he was packing an Uzi. Cows with guns. They came with a needle to stick in his thigh. He kicked for the groin. He pissed in their eye. Cow well hung. Knocked over a tractor and ran for the door. 6 gallons of gas flowed out on the floor. Run, cows, run. He picked up a bullhorn and jumped up on the hay. We are free-roving bovines. We run free today. We will fight for bovine freedom and hold our large heads high. We will run free with the buffalo or die. Cows with guns.
Okay, so I'll end it there. And whether you see Dana at a Unitarian church or at an environmentalist festival or whatever he's at, people start singing along with that song, and it's one of those places where I think he's just been genius as far as engaging people no matter where they're at. Like he says, if ranchers say, hey, I don't really believe in this whole climate change thing, but we are going to stop the coal trains, he'll talk about coal trains. He's a real organizer's attitude in that way, as opposed to sort of remaining some kind of Puritan that can't engage with people. And so that was one of the things that I think that across the board, I was surprised the extent to which so many of these musicians emphasize comedy as a genre. And that's true of the next one as well, but the other point I want to make here is about participatory performance. I think so often on the local scale, musicians want to kind of act as if what we're doing is the same thing that you two or somebody's doing on a larger scale, when in fact people expect a very different thing of local and hyper-local musics. What they really want is something more participatory. And in terms of what works as far as connecting people to the local ecosystems and doing something, it is that kind of participatory music. And one of the best examples are the Raging Grannies. I was extremely privileged to do a focus group interview with the original Gaggle. That is the members of the original Gaggle. There's only two that are still alive from the original set. But they keep their group in Victoria down to about 12, whereas other gaggles allow their gaggles to get rather large in Seattle and in San Francisco and other places. And these women are geniuses, and they really started in 1987 when they were opposing U.S. nuclear warships coming in Eskimo Bay in near Victoria and doing operations with the Canadian military. And these women found that not only were their opposition ignoring them, they kind of expected that, but also men in the movement that led the movement locally felt like they were getting ignored as well. And so at one momentous meeting where they're all together planning their actions, one said, what are we going to call ourselves? Somebody said, well, you know, they kind of treat us like we're grannies, so why don't we just call ourselves grannies? And another one got very angry and said, I'm not going to be a granny, I'm going to rage. And then they decided on the Raging Grannies. And they kind of adopted the stigma as their identity to put out that of the Raging Grannies. Went down the Salvation Army, got a bunch of granny wear. They adopt standards that everybody can sing with them together. And I would still say it's still the case that when they're at a protest, for example, at the Parliament lawn in BC, that the police and others don't know what to do with these women. They're extremely successful because they're able to sort of use that identity and turn it back, one that's supposed to be sort of depoliticized, and make it extremely political. And through participatory performance, really are able to mobilize, create a sense of esprit de corps that is really rather magical. They're not the only example of that. Here in Seattle, for example, the honk movement is pretty powerful, as in many U.S. cities. One band called Movitas, for example, playing at the Battle for Seattle. They're not really a case that I cover in the book per se, but I did interview them and go see them play. And here they are at the Paddle for Seattle that some of you might know about. So the example that the participatory sort of music is the kind of thing that really seems to matter. And a good book about that would be Mark Matern's book on political music. Another thing would be, per the point I made before, and these all connect, is the idea that even those that are professional educator musicians, like Bob's and Lolo that have a national syndicated show in Canada and play to throngs of really excited and happy toddlers, and as they point out, they have to continually renew their audience because their audience leaves them about every 1 or 2 years, that even they, instead of doing something that's really didactic, like here's what you should do, are more dialogic in a Freirean way, as I said, as far as bringing people into thinking about their local ecosystems and not hitting them over the head with it, but rather making it fun in some way. And that is true as well for the wilds. And I recently, up in Vancouver at the American Musicological Society, had all these folks come and play. And it was really amazing watching them all in one place. And it's part of where I started rethinking after the book some of the things that they're doing as well. The Wilds do this with high schools where they turn out hundreds of kids and thousands in the audience of their family singing about local salmon runs and restoration. And even to a certain extent, Enbridge and some political issues that Idle No More covers. And doing it in a way that is very educational, but not, as I said, didactic and hitting people over the head. Really learned a lot from them. And then the last one I want to talk about, actually I'm going to talk about two more sort of themes that run throughout before I show a couple of videos where I feel like trying to apply some of these lessons learned, if you will. And this next lesson is that of what Freire refers to as codification. It's really in many ways similar to a Stuart Hall style semiotics in terms of the reverse process, if you will, as opposed to decoding something, it's about putting together a code. Something that every movement needs is something that will symbolize and crystallize what they're doing. The same way ritual always works for human culture, so that people can point to it and say, that's what we're about. That's the sort of mythos, that's the ideology, that's an idea that we can point to, and it's more visceral, tangible than what we think on a sort of daily or rhetorical basis. And I think that's one of the things music can really do well when you look at movements of the past. We Shall Overcome, in the civil rights movement. Pretty much every movement has a couple iconic songs that people sing and think about as a way to generate a sense of this is who we are, both internally and externally. I think in terms of the environmental movement, this really hasn't developed to a certain extent that it has in past movements. And I think there's various reasons for that. So one of the things I was doing was looking for ways in which that can happen, and I think what one of the answers is it does happen more on a movement by a sort of sub-movement or local space. And I was particularly struck with how Idle No More, particularly in Canada, manages a soundscape in a way that codifies what they're about in a way that, at least from my own observation, was different than it often is the case with the left in the U.S. Specifically, both in terms of time and space, there was an incredible respect for what Jeff Todd Titan calls the sound commons. The idea that everybody's occupying the same space and therefore has to show respect through sound with each other and what they're doing. The main subject of the chapter I deal with Idle No More is Cecilia Point, who is a Musqueam MC. She describes herself as a hockey mom, and was kind of pressed into service because there was basically grave robbing going on by a development corporation, and she was asked to sort of testify against that, and she developed her own voice and became one of the most important MCs in the Idle No More movement in Western Canada. And one of the things I asked her about was, how is it that you've managed? And how do you sort of direct this in a way that people show such sonic respect in your protests? And she said she hadn't even really thought about it. It's something that just seems to have happened. But I was really found it remarkable the way that you have basically white musicians respecting the space of First Nations Indigenous drummers and singers to lead these marches, to be the sort of moral sonic core. And when they're done playing, whether it's on the march or to start, they then will play. And instead of overlapping in space with just sort of a cacophony of noise like we often get of competing interests sort of in the soundscape of a protest here, you have these incredibly respectful spaces, including the fact that most of the people in Idle No More, whether they're indigenous or not, recognize the fact that you do not play an indigenous song unless it's gifted to you. These are some things that you do not often see as much, I think, I would argue, in many protest sort of contexts in the U.S. where it's a little bit more anarchic or sonically competitive and not codifying what it's about as much in the movement. And this really starts from the very beginning with Idle No More, that was started by three First Nations women and one white woman that were working together in Moose Jaw, Saskatchewan. And I really think you can kind of see that orally coded in what it is they do in their protest soundscape. The other example of this would be Sharon Abreu. She and Michael Herkovitz are based in the San Juan Islands, but travel around the entire area and beyond. Sharon's been doing something called the climate monologues. And what I talk about in the book was what I found a rather remarkable case of articulation, where Sharon took her climate monologue. She's a classically trained musician and presents a monologue of one of her informants. Then she presents a song that's about that informant and their issue, in which she did that at a wonderful, in Anacortes, as part of a movement to stop the coal train, so that same issue that Dana Lyons was talking about at the beginning, and felt that part of her success was that ability to articulate, again, with that movement. And for her performance, at least in the nights where I've seen her do that, kind of once again codify what it is that the group is trying to do and make it tangible, give a sort of affective tinge to it that goes beyond the intellectualized discussion of the issues. And so once again, another case that I felt was very successful that I could learn from. The last one I'm going to talk about here before I show you a couple videos that are the applied end of this to finish up is the question of how local musicians can really mediate identity in place, connect us to the local ecosystem in a way that might matter in terms of sustainability, environmental health, biodiversity, etc. In this case, it's Adrian Shalafour, who's up on the bench here from Towers and Trees. And sadly, the band Towers and Trees has now broken up. It was a very sad message when I got it from Adrian, because they were really kind of one of those bands that was on the verge of kind of making it when things went wrong for them. But I was really struck by a video that I saw of Adrian's before I had ever met him, where he was singing in the middle of the woods outside his sister's house, singing a Canadian version of "This Land Is Your Land." And it really struck me as sort of the counter to Sherry Turkle's idea of being alone together, this idea that Sherry in particular saw kids around with their sort of phones and that kind of thing and thought, you know, we're not really co-present anymore, that even though people are in the same room and even though ostensibly they're connected to somebody elsewhere, that she would argue that that's just a digital representation of themselves, a sort of ego-driven thing where you can kind of control others as opposed to an authentic connection to somebody else. And so Sherry Turkle complains about that. And I think in many ways that's an overdrawn argument and probably generational. But I kind of found what Adrian was doing as a nice sort of hopeful moment to see that even locally, because it's a very local video, as opposed to like Dana Lyons, who has 3.6 million hits, there's still only about 1,200 or something on this. But it was circulating nicely in Victoria among his friends, and it really hit me as a hopeful way of thinking maybe of being together alone. That even if we're not in the same place, the fact that one is representing a connection to their local area might matter. In fact, Adrian made that argument when I talked to him. He said he feels like what he wants to do is, because his work and his music, some of their more popular music in addition to this, is about place, that somebody in Texas or anybody that's connected to place wherever they are, even though they might not be able to relate to that particular place, that they're sharing connections to place via social media. I'm going to leave it there as far as what I'm saying about that so I can play you these two videos, because really in some ways that is what we're trying to do in this thing I'm calling EcoSong. That as organizations have come to me and said, hey, could we make some media that's about what we're trying to do? In the case of Lake Pepin Legacy Alliance, recruit members. In the case of the Minnehaha Creek Watershed, educate people about rain gardens. And in each case now I've said to them, let's do something that's a little bit more creative. Your talking head videos are not really working for you. Is there some other way we could do this? And I've really tried to apply what I've learned in doing this research in what you're about to see. And so turning to that, I'm going to play both of these most recent music videos that we've done. I want to do a little bit of bragging here. To my shock and awe, they've won some film festival awards. It's been kind of nice and surprising. I am a little bit bummed out because my bandmate Tim Gustafson wrote this song, and actually he's won more than that since, and I wrote this song. So there's a little bit of tension that's come out of all this, you know. So anyway, I'm going to play these for you, and in both cases, I hope you can see how the various lessons I learned here in your backyard are the things that I took back to Minnesota in making these pieces of media for these organizations. So we'll start with We Live in the Lake.
We live in the lake. We live in the lake. We live in the lake. We live in the lake. Put all the people on alert. Lake Pepin's filling up the dirt. But there's something you can do. Join me at the other crew. Silt and sand and rock and roll.
So one thing I would say about this as it's sort of rolling credits is that in addition to being participatory, the element of music, not as far as just bringing together people kind of metaphorically or spiritually, but literally in an entrainment. The crazy fish dance is now being done at their various events, and they get together and they move together, and there's some power in that that I think is really cool. And it's just been really fun to play a part in that and also see the ways in which the sort of where it started and then where it ends up being nothing like what was originally in any of our heads, even down to things like it was supposed to be a punkier sound and becomes kind of klezmer as the various instruments get involved and that kind of thing. And now I think a fairly different one, the last one I'll end on, is You Can Build a Garden. And this one was Minnehaha Creek Watershed, and they're more like I said, our long-term partner is Metro Blooms, where we put in rain gardens with them and do creative media around what they do. And it's one of the most well-heeled watershed districts probably in the country, where you've got rich folks in Minnetonka in that area that pay for a lot of it, but not reaching a lot of the people that are neglected in the inner city. There's an environmental justice issue. So what we wanted to do is hold a sort of community song contest in the Powderhorn Park where we had done other work and see if some community singers would come forth. And what we got was amazing, including just one person I'll mention here, Gianthi Kyle, who wrote the song Hand to Hand for the Black Lives Matter movement, and have that articulation then with what we were doing and having yet another connection that made this meaningful. And so here's the song that resulted, the video that resulted, You Can Build a Garden.
All the rain runs down the shingles and the downspouts, over sidewalks and driveways and roads,
on down the gutter into the storm drain, to the rivers and the lakes and seas it goes, with the fertilizer and the gasoline, with pesticides and herbicides and other things in between.
Heavy
So to wrap up, that's kind of bringing it back, all back home, to use my advisor, Jerry Behrman.
A healthy community means to me that neighbors are interacting and they're doing things together that they're passionate about, whether that's about the environment or just beautifying their backyards.
Laura.
Metro Lums is
an... All right. So really, bringing back home, my advisor wrote a fairly well-known piece in anthropology called Bringing Back Home about the need to make ethnography relevant by bringing it back home and doing something with it, which is really what I'm trying to do. So just to really quickly tell you about our next steps before closing it so that I can get your ideas. One of the things that we're doing right now is an anthropogenic disruption video about noise pollution and the way in which mainly bird, frog, and whale communication is disrupted by noise. It's based in this area. It's a longer, like about a 10-minute piece, and it's less of a music video, less song-driven, and more of a sound composition that shows images, sort of juxtaposing these images, including with orca whales. The other one is another commissioned piece that we're doing is sodium chloride in watersheds, the road salts problem, which is huge in the Midwest. And then a bigger one that we're trying, the CIC, which is basically most of the Big Ten institutions. It's kind of weird how it's, I think, the only football conference that's also an academic consortium, but they have money. We might be getting a fairly large grant to do this work with one of my students in India, with Rebecca Dickerson, who's at Indiana and at Harvard, who might be doing her work in Haiti with this, and then my own work might return to Mexico for it. So doing this on an international scale with music videos, and it very much would be that template of what you just saw. And then the last one I wanted, this is sort of shameless plug that I'm really nervous about. I don't really like to take on concert production for this reason of feeling responsible, but Dana is going to be giving a concert at Dobe Resort on June 28th, and it's going to be his first ever filmed live concert. He doesn't have a full-length concert film, so Elja's coming out to direct that. So if anybody wants to come up to Dobe Resort on Orcas on June 28th, I'd love to buy your ticket because I want to make sure that it is filled and people are participating. So
send
that's
us the URL.
What's that?
Send us the URL.
I will do that. Okay. Yep, and the Eventbrite. Okay. Yeah, it'd be great to have people there. So anyway, that's really what I am doing, and that's what the book is about. But for me, to a certain extent, it's the afterlife of the book that matters the most to me. And I would love to have your thoughts on any of this. And in particular, also, like I said before we got started here, I would love to have your ideas about how to put some of this more in motion as far as facilitating really what the musicians are doing in a way that can have value added from a communication scholar's perspective. So thank you very much. I used a somewhat of a snowballing method. First, there are the ones that, by virtue of the last chapter of the first book, takes place sort of in this area where I'm playing locally, and through that, like people like Carolyn Caruso kept talking about Dana Lyons, you know, and that was one that just jumped out. Beyond that, I think it's a rare enough bird, as far as people that do music or some connected environmental issues, that I was really keeping my ears out with them of who else they played with. And that is one of the reasons why Seattle's less represented than I would like. There were no sort of musicians that just jumped out as far as doing this kind of work like Dana does. And then Vancouver, for some reason, Vancouver, Victoria seem to be hotbeds for people, and I don't know if they have the audience or what to do this. So I used kind of a snowballing method and really looked hard. And so I found myself, for example, spending time in Olympia and Seattle and not finding any musicians of this sort of level of dedication. And that just makes sense. I mean, at this point, it's hard to imagine many musicians being supported doing topical music that's environmentalist, et cetera. I mean, even in the past, these were usually musicians that are well established, like a Pete Seeger in the old left, who decides to take this on and got criticized by the new and old left for doing environmentalist work for various different reasons. So I think it's something that still is somewhat new enough that I don't think you can expect to find a lot of it. Now, having done this since, now I am getting these Facebook requests, especially of young musicians who are doing this, want to do more of it, touring on bikes, doing this great stuff, who are kind of very hopeful to make something happen. And that's, I guess, the next level of this, people, you know, creating more of this. You know. Please.
So early in the talk, you talked about how effect is something that you're really interested in, like what is the impact of this. And you also mentioned polysemy and satire, and I'm thinking of that first song, especially How With Guns, which I had not heard before. It's hilarious. And something that apparently the artist says, you know, appeals to different audiences, and I can see how that could be the case, vegetarians and ranchers, right? Mm-hmm. But what does it say to them? I mean, what is the effect of a message that could mean different things?
Right, and that's the problem with the politics of polysemy, right? I mean, hopefully it's not too much of a tangent, but it's been one of my sort of criticisms as I engage with some fellow musicologists in the AMS, where they will sort of attack the artlessness of political music by being too denotative as opposed to art, which they kind of articulate as having to be how scenic, open interpretations, but I think there's almost a bourgeois aspect to that, right? It's safe to be something that's so nebulous and bland that it doesn't really say anything to anybody. Now, having said that, I think one of the things that you see as far as the artful politics of polysemy is that it's more of an opening. So that they know Dana Lyons is connected in some way to some of these movements if they're on the left, and so they say, I'm going to read Cows with Guns to be a sort of critical thing about the ag industry, and we're going to talk about issues of GMOs and that kind of thing. And for those that don't know that, it's going to be an opening because they just love that funny song they heard on Dr. Demento, and they want to have Dana come talk to them, and he therefore has an opening to talk about these various issues. I guess that's, in this case, that's it. And in fact, if there's one thing that goes across these two, it's usually not the song like A Big Yellow Taxi or some song. I mean, Dana has several songs that are much more explicitly environmentalist. I'm not sure what they do in the sense that that's, you can almost see sometimes in his concerts that he starts to lose half of the audience as he gets too much into that material, and he's just genius at going, nope, better bring it back to Cows with Guns or Ride the Lawn or some sort of participatory thing to get him back on with me. So I think that's the balance that something like that, that he's playing with that. You know, I don't think it's as much as a sort of message-driven thing. And then there's the aspect of making a living. You know, how do you make a living doing songs that are sort of going to be sort of critical all the time? To a certain extent, that's a luxury that's given to folks like Bono or David Byrne, whoever, who establish themselves and then have the kind of cultural capital to also do this sort of critical Peter Gabriel style, critical music about apartheid or something. But most localized artists don't kind of have that luxury or standing to do that.
Can I ask a follow-up on that, please? So I hadn't heard of Dana before reading your book, and I went to EcoSong after learning about it, and because I wanted to watch Dana's Savage Sea video, which I can see, you know, you have on the screen, but you didn't play for us today. But that is unambiguous in its critique, right? So right next, literally, on that same webpage, there's, right, it's your construction, right? It's like, here's Cows with Guns, and right next to it is the sea. So we've got Polysemy on one side, and it's really sharp critique by the same musician. So are you saying that his strategy is to use the polysemic music to draw crowds and then try to feed them?
I think so. I think you're right. Sort of Trojan horse or a gateway drug that, yeah, here you've got the stuff that people are there for. You know, half the audience is kind of core that is already there. The other half are the ones that aren't so sure. So he kind of wants to carefully read the room and do that. And that's what the really impressive musical organizers, I think, are able to do that like he does. Another one in Minnesota is Larry Long, who just can read a room so well. And if people are not going to be where he can do a song like the Great Salish Sea, just won't do it, you know, because he'd rather be engaging people and having some chance with them to sort of then after the concert feel like I really got my message across, but people didn't, you know, care. So I think that's it, that sort of Trojan horse gateway drug sort of thing. I use the gateway drug one because there's this wonderful octogenarian member of the Metro News board that was doing the same thing with rain gardening. And he said, people say we're in Northeast, we're in this low-income area, is doing gardening, and they're saying you should be doing environmental justice or whatever. And he goes, I don't think that they've noticed, but gardening is our gateway drug to environmental justice. You know, that I think that that's true of a lot of really effective organizing, not just musical, but other ones.
Maybe I just link to this question, what is it that this music does as opposed to slogans of protest or something like that?
Yeah.
What is it that's specific about this? Mm-hmm. Is it that it hits people at a different moment in time, which is to say either before or after, but not during a protest? Mm-hmm. Is it that it encourages, you know, several readings that makes it possible for different types of people to reflect to different degrees about environmental themes? Yeah, what is the, what does this music do?
Yeah, in different contexts it does different things, but I think you're really on to something. I think music like this, like when I talk about Dana Lyons at a Unitarian church or someplace that's a base for organizing, if you will, it creates that sense of esprit de corps
where people want to be there, they want to be in a more celebratory mood, they want to kind of be participating in it and feel like something's happening, but it's different than the sort of protest moment where the slogan's coming out and that kind of thing that is a little bit more externally driven. Like, we together are making this argument externally. It's a little bit more we together and what do we want to do to create and form a sense of who we are as a community so that we can mobilize to do that other work. So I think that, that those are both important forms of music, but I think the sort of anthem style music and most, you know, Raging Grannies is a good example of people that are basically doing that work outside in the protest context. But that sort of anthem-driven music, it's pretty rare when that kind of hits in a way that I think, for example, Gianfi's Hand to Hand might be one of those few examples where I can think of when somebody purposely creating an anthem that kind of does articulate into the local area and matter in a way that We Shall Overcome does, or some of these other musics. I feel like I didn't completely answer your question, probably because I'm still working that out. You know?
But also, what strikes me is, I mean, we know from studies of environmental messaging that positive framing is more effective than negative framing, and I think the music, you know, the message is serious and might even, you know, have warnings in it, but the music gives it sort of a positive ambiance, a positive framing that I think might make it more have more impact.
Yeah, and working against expectation. I mean, mm-hmm. We see that environmental documentary, at least for years, it was sort of, you almost know in terms of the soundscape of the soundtrack what's going to happen. It's going to be the sort of dystopian drone that gives you a headache, and then at the end, the obligatory happy, happy, whatever, you know. And that some other kinds of musics that people want to, not that are external, but the kind of musics people care about, I think is one of the powers here, too, you know.
And then there's the double layered thing that's occurring. Do you know the song Belching Bovines?
No.
The Bellingham Group, I think.
Really?
My 11-year-old heard the song, just thinks it's hysterical. Found it on Spotify, you played it for us. And at first I thought, okay, so it's mocking the research that shows that methane from cows is affecting climate. So mocking that, but actually the whole message of the song is affirming the human effect on climate. So it's basically like, don't blame, ultimately to me, the metaphor is like, don't blame cows, it's us.
Right, yeah.
But because it's mocking this research that, you know, cows are creating so much methane and spreading the environment, it's drawing in people who are perhaps skeptical, perhaps, mm-hmm. like, isn't this ridiculous? Another ridiculous academic thing, right?
Right.
But the overall message is, it's us, not the cows. Mm-hmm. And that's it. So, you know, and I had to ask my daughter, so what do you think this song is about? She's like, well, there comes to the environment, it's not because. Like, she got it. Right? Oh, she knows that. I was like, okay. But, you know, she had to listen to you a couple of minutes. She still just likes it because it's talking about body functions of cows. So that's she'll sing it because of that. I'm like, okay, I bet there are a lot of 20-year-old guys doing the same thing.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. And I think that's another point. It goes back to your good question, too, that I think what a lot of musicians do, like I think of Peter Gabriel and Biko, I'm sure 90-some percent of the people listening to Biko never even learned who Biko was. I mean, I literally remember dancing to the song one time and somebody said, who's Biko? You know, whatever, this is back in the day. You know, I think that musicians recognize that there's you know, two readings of all these things. There's the reading that however you want to take it, but please take it. And then there's reading like, so maybe some people go a little bit deeper and see what this song is about on another level. Born in the USA, there's so many songs that are like that. And I don't think it's a criticism of the song so much as you're pointing out with the Belching Bovines. It's kind of a virtue of that music.
Which you mentioned the three criteria that you used to pick these cases, and the third one being that really high bar.
Yeah.
Which of the cases meets that the most, and how or why?
You know, I think Dana, I have, at least in terms of my amateur historicism, or historiography, looking back, for example, at the referendum that was passed to defeat Hanford here in Washington. Now, the state referendum can just can't defeat a federal policy, but it did. And I have seen very little historical evidence that many people were even dealing with the issue before Dana and his friends were playing music and going around tirelessly dealing with this. They even got it down to a what they called the finger pole. They'd go by with a casket of uranium, and by that people were aware of it in Washington, especially in Eastern Washington, and people would either give the thumbs up or give them a finger. And they started collecting those, and there were 80 thumbs up, and 80% thumbs up, and 20% fingers, and it passed 80%. That is completely anecdotal, but in a couple of these cases, and especially thinking in localness, in that case the state, and some of the stuff hyper-local, I really believe that this music is doing something that you can point to and at least make the argument that it kind of matters in that way. Now, if one had to really, rigorously defend that, I don't think I could.
I have a question about the audience of the different groups, musical groups. How do I frame this? Was it that you saw, is it sort of a, what are the demographics? Is it a white middle class audience that they're reaching, or do they cut across class and race? And who is going to be missing or not?
They're different audiences. So Idle No More, for example, is very much more First Nations led. And like I said, that's an incredible virtue of that, that it's not just your, I'm a little bit reticent to say the expected, because I think there's two discourses. There's the sort of critique discourse that the sort of nationally known movement is white in the United States, and then a discourse about that being white that doesn't always resonate with the truth, and really makes a lot of, including people of color that have been leaders in these movements, kind of anger for being ignored by those that critique it for being white, as if that's a sort of, when in fact, I think in most of these movements, depending on where you are, you do see that there is much greater diversity, probably even in the local area. Now, having said that, I have found that, for example, Dana's based in Bellingham. Bellingham's a pretty white city. Victoria, Raging Granny's, Victoria's a pretty white city. And so I think there is sort of, it's pretty palpably obvious that there is not a great diversity there, as there is, for example, even with what we do in Minneapolis, where you get much more diversity, Somali, Ethiopian, Hmong communities getting involved a little bit more directly. Movidas, extremely diverse group. But I think that's what I would say, is that there are different audiences. And that's probably related to genres as well. One of the things that really surprised me as I'm going around, and I'm going just over the border from Bellingham to Vancouver, is that Bob's and Lolo and the Wilds and some of these folks I'm dealing with, Adrian Shalapour, had never heard of Dana, and Dana's never heard of them. Until I got them together in Vancouver at that concert, they had not interacted. So that's a whole other issue, but the power of that border that we think of as so imaginary, because fish go past it all the time, is a real thing when it comes to the actual mixing of human beings that are doing, that's not a border for capital or anything else, or for pipelines or anything, but it's a real border for local musicians to go across and to get things done in the Salish Sea.
A sort of flip version of that question, which is less about the audiences and more about the producers, but I think it's with the same spirit in mind. So like, how does Dana decide to become Dana? Like, it's not what's the social profile and the social trajectory of the people, either in terms of background, like what their parents did, what they're exposed to, or class composition? What is that, and are there similarities across the cases, or is it just really different? It almost sounds like
it's a great question.
It's another field of environmental music protest if they're not aware of it.
Yeah, so how does one sort of enter that field in sort of to say this is something I could be, And part of the answer is that thing that I'm still mystified by. I don't think a little Bobby Zimmerman from northern Minnesota can be sane at all if he thinks with that voice that he's ever going to become Bob Dylan. Yet he keeps going for years in the village when he's getting no feedback because it's just something he has to do. And eventually it works, so that's cool with him too. And he tries out different personae. You know, he was Woody for a while, because I'll try out my Woody Guthrie persona. It was something else until Bob Dylan works as a persona. I see the same thing with Dana, although Dana hedged his bets a little bit. He was thinking of going to law school if this music thing didn't pan out. But I think eventually the music thing just became something that he could not not do. And that's true both in terms of their musicianship and then making it doubly difficult for themselves by being musicians that are sort of socially committed. And I think with all of them you see that struggle. Dana is not, despite having a very successful song that he still tours in Australia and Ireland, everywhere, every year, still basically lives in his garage with his cat. You know, that's a successful musician. And then others like Sharon is constantly, how do I teach local lessons or whatever to keep this going, yet still be able to practice my art in a way that's meaningful. I'm still in awe of the people that do that. I think one of the reasons we're in academe is because there is a path and a field there that we can do, that I'm just awe of these people that say to their parents and everybody else, I'm going to do this, you know. And I think one of the things that does help, there is sometimes almost, and this goes back to your question a little bit, a geographic nexus there. Dana is from 15 miles away from where Pete Seeger had his Clearwater, the boat, you know, that would go up and down the Hudson River and talk about this. He kind of soaked it in, so much so that when I asked him, you know, why do so many environmentalists come from this area in New York and then have had such an impact? He didn't even have an answer. It was kind of like the water he breathed. Water he breathed, that wouldn't be good. But like the air he breathed, the water he drank, it was what he did and what a lot of people, I think, thought in those areas. Whereas I'm almost more in awe of somebody from Hibbing, Minnesota, the center on the side who's going to be world famous, you know, Nobel Prize winner or something like that. So I don't know the answer to that. I wish we could figure that out. I wish we could figure it out for our students, because there's part of us that want to say, yeah, you're crazy if you're going to think you're going to make a living doing this, as cool as you think it is. On the other part, it's like, thank goodness some people decide to do that kind of craziness. You know?
Have you found that the music genre for this environmental, is it overwhelmingly sort of in the folk kind of tradition? I mean, do you get ska or bhangra or R&B environmental music?
Mm-hmm. Did you say bhangra? That would be cool. Yeah.
But do you run across that, or is it really overwhelmingly because of that focus on the importance of lyric and the message that it's mostly that kind of folk genre?
I have a whole section in that first book, that 2012, on genre and trying to figure out why is it that this kind of music, and most topical music, is associated with more soloists than with bands, and sort of talk about the political economic reasons for that, but also I think in genre expectations of the audience, yeah. And I think there's a lot of reasons for that, but definitely there's a sort of, that is where a lot of them are playing towards expectation in terms of Dana. I think that he recognizes that sort of there's an expectation of kind of an Americana folk, kind of rocky, whatever, and those are the people, that's the music you do, and that's what sort of works in this genre. Having said that, there's a wonderful article that needs updating, and I hope she does at some point, but Deborah Rosenthal wrote a book about rap and hip-hop as environmentalist music that's really well done. And it's a question that comes out a lot when I talk to people that are in popular music studies, that there are people like Mos Def and others that have done really cool environmentalist music in hip-hop context, and that this goes back to your question of sort of diversity, ethnicity, and environmental justice. Why is it we don't see some of those types of music, urban musics, as environmentalist, when in fact those of us that live in the middle of a city stacked into little boxes have some of the smallest footprints. And when I'm out on Orcas, I do just the opposite. You know, when you're in a rural area, you are, you know, basically an energy hog, you know, unless you're, you know, doing agriculture or something like that to contribute, you actually inordinately unsustainable lifestyle. Yet we associate this sort of agrarian pastoral music with environmentalism. And I think more needs to be done on that, if that's one thing, because so much of the studies are involved Western classical music, so somebody like Ferdy Grofe, who does the Grand Canyon Suite, or my good friend Denise Van Glenn, who writes about women and the skillful listener, a brilliant book. but they're about Libby Larson's classical musics. There's some studies of like the Pete Seeger and the sort of folky stuff, but there's not enough like Deb Rosenthal's done on hip hop and other musics. But to get to your point also, I think there's real conundrums in terms of some of the most popular musics like rock, because at the very time where it sort of, the big mega event was the answer to everything, right? You have a human rights problem, you have this huge big benefit concert, and it's gonna work. That came to an end with Live Earth, because the conundrums and contradictions of it were so great that it was representing the problem more than it was sort of, this is how we mobilize a large group of people to do something about it. Sorry, that was a long answer to your question, but it's a good question.
I was hearing, I don't know a lot about music, but I was hearing folk, certainly, but I was also hearing country, and it seems it seems like that country, if you're trying to address an audience that may be skeptical about climate change, or skeptical about environmental hippies, that the line between folk and country is, you know, not that strong, but to push over into the more country music.
Yeah, and I think you're right, and that's what Dana does. That's a really good, that's a good answer to your question, because like one of the things that Dana and his friends have done is they have these camel hats that say No Coltrane, and they wear them and they look like they're ranchers or whatever, and they talk about how the politicians that they talk to don't know what to do with them, because the politicians are so used to putting people in boxes and saying, oh, we can dependently say that these guys wearing camo, these white guys wearing camo, whatever, are going to be safely, whatever, on excise, and we know we don't have to really deal with them. It's the others that might agitate or whatever. And mixing those two, like you said, in terms of genre, country music and that, and then even mixing the clothing styles to say, it almost tries to deconstruct, in this case, the local politicians' ideas of who people are in their own local areas, you know. Which is always more complicated, I think, than we get in that sort of urban vision of media, what people are like in a rural area. I guess I kind of feel like that myself, being from rural Iowa, and knowing what the sort of impressions are and how easy it is to use that as kind of the straw man, if you will.
Could you tell us about the story of the Great Sound?
Oh, of Dana's Great Sailor Sea song? I can play you a little bit for it. You know, it was interesting. It really almost developed, I think, as part of this, in a weird way, as part of the research. He was starting to do it. But let's see here. I also think Dana's becoming somewhat aware that people are thinking about him as sort of a legacy artist and what his legacy is going to be. So for example, part of it came out of when the, you know about the Elwha Dam, one of the few dams that's been taken down so you could restore Salmon Run. And that moment really moved him to be there and see that possibility and to be part of, he's been working really well with Lumi artists, including Jewel, who does the great totem poles that are taken and as part of this tour as well. And he every once in a while wants to do, I think, more of a sort of anthemic song to go with his more sort of fun and participatory songs. Having said that, I don't even know if I should say this, but he just recently went to Alaska and was part of a movement there where I swear he's using the same song and just using different words, so. Yeah, she did.
Shores of emerald isles with salmon spawn.
song today. The salmon gone, the herring late, and more the ships to come. Will anybody hear my song? Or hear the scream of the ships on the water? The great super tankers, the coal ports, the freighters, the deafening noise overtaking the water, the deafening noise overcoming the order. Remember the legend, the myth and the story, a long time ago we witnessed the glory with thousands and thousands of whales swimming free. The ark has come home to the great sailor's sea. Oh, hear the voice from both sides of the border, the rallies, the blockades, the brave sons and daughters. The people speak out for protecting the water. The people are rising to come save the water.
I do think Dana needs a better publicist, because wherever he does play, he really has an impact. I was speaking at University of Charleston in South Carolina and mentioning Dana, and suddenly all the students in the place just really lit up. You know Dana Lyons? I'm like, you know Dana Lyons? He had been there performing, you know, a couple of months before, and they just all really loved him, you know. So I think that this was the plan, is to have a Great Sailor Sea tour. I don't think it's gone quite as well as he wanted, in part because there's some other things that developed in terms of the coal trains and the oil train issues that took him to the side. But I think he's still wanting to do a Sailor Sea tour where he goes all around the Sailor Sea. So if you know any of student groups in at the University of Washington that might want to host him, I think it'd be a great event. Well, thank you. You've been an extremely good audience, and I appreciate your questions and your thoughts. And please be in contact if you have any others, including organizations that might want to interact with some of these artists.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.